Now, do the Vrajavasis know that Krishna is God, or do they not know that he is God? What do you think? They know? How many of you think they know that he is God? Okay. How many of you think that they don't know he is God? Okay. This is one answer where both are right. So, they know that Krishna is God, but that knowledge doesn't stay in the forefront of their consciousness. There are times when they offer prayers to Krishna also, but that is not at the forefront. The example given by Acharyas is that the stars in the sky are present even in the daytime. But because the sun is so bright, the stars can't be seen. So similarly, here they compare that the stars are like the Aishwarya Gyan of Krishna. That Krishna is God. Krishna is Vishnu himself. All this knowledge is like the stars. They're star-like truths. But their love for Krishna is like the sun. And because the love for Krishna is so great, that the awareness of Krishna's divinity goes into the background. It is there, but it is not at the forefront. And we see this dynamic very beautifully in the Gopi Gita, where the gopis are praying to Krishna to please come back. The five chapters of the 10th canto, 29 to 33, are called the Rasa Panchadhyaya. And they are considered the zenith, the summit, the climax, the pinnacle of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And this is like a five-act play. You know, sometimes the play is there. You come on the stage and then the curtains fall after one scene is over. Again, the curtains open. Another scene is there, like that. So the first stage is where Krishna plays the flute and calls the gopis. The second stage is where the gopis rush to the forest and they talk with Krishna. And as they're talking with Krishna, as the Rasa is about to begin, the gopis disappear. Krishna disappears. And the gopis in agony search everywhere for Krishna, in frenzy. And finally, when they can't find, they start calling him out, begging him to come through prayers. That is the 31st chapter. Very sweet and beautiful prayers. And 32nd chapter is where Krishna appears. And when he appears, the gopis are in ambivalence. Ambivalence means there are two different emotions going on. Now suppose, you know, there are parents and the child has run away from home. And then the parents, finally the child is found and the child comes back. Now at the one level, the parents are furious. How can you run away like this? How can you put us in anxiety like this? But at another level, the parents are afraid. If you get too angry, he may run away again. So they don't know what to do. They want to discipline the child, but they have to check their emotions. So the gopis are also in that situation. They're angry with Krishna. Hello, we left everything and came to you and you left us. So they want to vent their anger to Krishna, but at the same time they're afraid Krishna may go away again. So what they do is they use a standard strategy. That is, ask questions in the third person. You know, Krishna, you know, what do you think about different kinds of lovers? Now, some lovers, if you love them, they reciprocate. Some lovers, to the extent you love them, they reciprocate much more. And some lovers, no matter how much you offer love, they never reciprocate. So what kind of lovers are the best? Now, indirectly, what are they doing? You say, Krishna, why are you acting like this third category of the lover? So it's a very indirect but clear form of criticism. So sometimes, some people try to be politically correct while being socially incorrect. Now they want to criticize someone and they tell everything that that person has done, but just don't mention the name. So they say, I never mentioned the name, but everybody understands who they are talking about. So the gopis, when they're talking like this, Krishna understands. So then Krishna replies and says, actually, your devotion for me is so great that I can never do anything to reciprocate with your love. Na paarayeham. That I am indebted to you so much that I can never repay you. But He said, I went away not because I don't appreciate your love, but because I wanted to raise your love to a further intensity. And you have demonstrated your unbreakable love for me. And thus, I am forever indebted to you. And in the last chapter, this is the 31st chapter, 27, this is the 32nd chapter. And the 33rd chapter is where the gopis and Krishna perform the rasa dance. So before this, why I'm discussing this is, do the Vrajavasis know that Krishna is God? So Jiva Goswami explains that there are that all the verses that are there in the Gopi Gita, that each verse is composed by one gopi. And she is expressing her heart to Krishna, and she is also acting as a representative of the group. And by analyzing the characters of the various gopis, Ruju Goswami explains, this gopi has this emotion. So this verse is, this prayer is sung by this gopi, this prayer is sung by this gopi. So it's quite esoteric. But for our relevance, the gopis exhibit both knowledge of Krishna's divinity and lack of knowledge of Krishna's divinity. So for example, when Krishna has gone away and they are all beseeching Krishna to come back and they are requesting him in different ways. So they say in one prayer, Pranata Kamadam, Pranata Dehinam, Papa Karshanam, Truna Charanugam, Shri Niketanam, Pani Panarpitam, Te Padambujam, Kruna Kucheshuna, Krundiruchayam. So they're glorifying the lotus feet of Krishna and they say, Krishna, your lotus feet are so great that if anybody bows down to them, Papa Karshanam, all their sins will be destroyed. But still, wonder of wonders, those lotus feet which have such potency, what are they doing? Truna Charanugam, Shri Niketanam. They are going after the cows. They are serving the cows. And yet, despite doing such a menial activity, still they remain Shri Niketanam. They remain the abode of the goddess of fortune. And then, each of these prayers, if you understand, it is a call for Krishna to come back. And they say, Fani Fanarpitam Te Padambujam. Krishna, you offered your lotus feet to the Fani. Who is the Fani?
Kaliya.
So they are in a poetic way saying, Krishna actually danced on Kaliya. Kaliya did not think it was an offering.
It was a domination for him, like thunderbolt striking.
But the gopis in a poetic way are saying, Krishna, you offered your lotus feet even to a snake like Kaliya. So please, why don't you offer those lotus feet to us? Please come back. So here in this verse, it's clear that the gopis know that Krishna is God. And they know Krishna's lotus feet are so powerful that they can even crush Kaliya's venomous hooves. And yet, a few verses later, the same gopis pray that Nalina Sundaram Nathate Padam Shilatrunankurai Sidatitina Kalilatam Manaha Kantagachati. So they say, Nalina Sundaram, your lotus feet are softer and sweeter and more attractive than lotus flowers. They're tender like lotus flowers. Nathate padam. O master, those feet of yours, Shilatrunankurai. That in the forest of Vrindavan, when you're gone away from us, now you're barefoot. So the pebbles, the thorns, the branches, they will all be pricking your feet. And when we think of how your lotus feet will be scratched, that thought is ripping our heart apart. So please, Krishna, come back. So each of these prayers, if we see, the mood is, please come back. Please come back. So one is, please offer the lotus feet, which are so glorious, which you offer to somebody who is so inglorious also. But please come back and offer those lotus feet. Now, saying, Krishna, it is your lotus feet. If they get hurt, we can't bear it. So please come back. And they will conclude with, Krishna, your lotus feet are our only shelter. So please come back and give us shelter. Without them, we are lost. So the point I'm making here is that the gopis know that Krishna is so powerful, he is God, he can destroy our sinful reactions, he can subdue Kaliya. So that knowledge is there. But when they are thinking of serving Krishna, at that time, they don't think, oh, Krishna's lotus feet, what is going to happen to them? You know, he says he can crush Kaliya. But no, they think that Krishna, your lotus feet will be scratched by the thorns and pebbles of Vrindavan. So such is the nature of love. In love, we primarily focus on service. So the Vrajavasis, they know that Krishna is God, but because their desire to serve Krishna is so great, that awareness that Krishna is God goes into the background. And they just think, how best can I serve Krishna? So now Yashoda Mai is often very anxious to give Krishna food at the right time. If she thinks Krishna is God, Krishna is everybody's annadata, then how can she have that anxiety? So she has that awareness, but that awareness goes to the background.